C-section control, a new modification for EggOpen GPS.
The one thing I did like about USB is when you plug it in, you get power. What I didn't like was that if you cracked off one of these ends or you damaged the cable, you'd have to wait for a store to open to go pick up a new one. Using power over Ethernet, you get the handiness of a USB port, but it's much more robust and you can make your own cables. You can get replacement ends that just crimp on with pliers. All you do is just crimp it, and then you have a custom sized cable for up to 100 meters. Powering a 12 to 48 volt converter off of bench supply so I can keep track of the watts. That powers this PoE switch, and then it powers the devices down the line. This is an AT switch. It only gives out power if what's connected on the other end negotiates for the power. So some of the costs involved with the system. So you got about $5 for a nano, and it's basically $10 for the Ethernet port. This is a 12 volt relay board, and then it hooks directly to the nano along these pins, and it looks to be about $25. The one to run the section control, it is another, we'll say $10. Also the 5 volt version that I'm using to run the Teensy at the moment. So they're all about $10. And then this switch, I got it off of AliExpress, but now their store isn't open anymore. So I'm wondering what's up with that. The one I had picked up originally was not PoE, though it looks very similar. So you gotta make sure it's actually PoE. Identical switches, except this one is PoE. It's the TP. And then this one is not PoE, it's the TX. For section control, we're at about $50 Canadian. So just with the switch running, I'm burning about 1 watt of power at 13.1 volts. The GPS is still just on USB because I ran out of PoE splitters, but it'll be on PoE too. Here's the splitter that runs the Teensy. This module, you would have the Teensy and you would have the BNO. And you would have the ADS that would be on the side of the tractor and stay with the tractor. Not a bad design, really. Like, there's next to nothing for soldering. I would like a bit of a board. You don't even have to put anything in between it and the nano. It can just run it. Though I do have a resistor on this one because one of the LEDs up here was sympathetically blinking. Probably wouldn't be a bad idea to put them on the rest of the outputs. Let's plug another item in. Let's plug in the Teensy. So there we got power. We are now at 2.6 watts. Let's power up the sectional control. Sending GGA and VTG. The Teensy is getting the GGA data, and then it's also spitting out the panda sentence to the network. I'm not sure why at the moment, but sometimes I'm having to restart this nano, restarted the data. So there is one port left, and that'd be for a cab module. So that'd be for a joystick or your electric steering module or whatever else you need to do inside the cab. With everything powered up so far, I'm only at 13.2 watts total. So that would be the switch, that would be the Teensy, and that would be the section control as well. With the Ethernet module, you'll only get 14 sections instead of 16. And the reason being is these three digital pins are reserved to talk to that board. Cleaned up this portion here to take advantage of as many of the relays as possible. For those of us who aren't the greatest programmers, notes are really handy. I also made a few changes right here, so it wasn't that many changes. Might as well leave them all configured. Don't see any reason not to. You can just turn them on and off from EggOpen GPS. EggIO successfully found the section control. As much fun as it is to watch the Teensy make the panda sentence, I'm gonna be using the simulator to test the sectional control. Unplug the GPS, cycle through the relays. We start turning off relays.
There's two off, three off. There's 10 relays power down. And there we go. So that'd be normal field operation. When you're cruising around and all your sections are working, you'd be burning 4.3 watts.
For those of you who haven't played with simulator yet, this is the speed of the tractor and this steers the tractor. Steering. I want to record a boundary. And this is going to take forever, so I'm going to speed up this tractor. Now that the field's made, we're going to add an AB line. Clicked AB and they light up now. It's nice. So we will add and set my A and close enough. There we go. Here we see a very strange U-turn, and then I was told today by Brian that I'll have to adjust the tractor steering radius each time to optimize that, so I'm going to be increasing it. Start off doing a few headlands. You can really speed the simulator up. There we go, farming at 55 kilometers an hour. Here we go, what's it gonna do? Is it gonna jump to the line outside? Or is it gonna jump to the line inside? Okay, now we're going over old territory again. Wish I could hop to the inside. Here I am just stuck on the merry-go-round. It would be nice to have a force path, you know, over button. But the reason why it draws a line outside of bounds the very first time is because it's measuring off the last. So it has to ride outside of bounds for it to follow it on the inside. But why won't it transition over to the next headland path? Fully stopped, all of the relays turn off. If we go and we speed up, you turn on. Nice ding. Too bad I can't hear that on my actual tractor. Here we go again. Let's take a look at the relays this time. Coming out of the corner. All just off one Ethernet cable. So you just run one Ethernet cable from the tractor out to where you'd have that mounted to run your clutches. Here we have Wireshark. I'm gonna click on my Ethernet and I'm gonna take a small sample of UDP and stop. If we put in UDP.port, it'll only show the UDP. This network, it's connected to my house router, so it's seeing all traffic. I'm trying to make collisions, which I still haven't been able to make. There you can see the GGA sentence. There's the panda sentence created just after it. The data colorized. So you can see green is the GGA, and then pink is the panda leaving, and then the blue ones are corrections. Here you can see a giant TCP router packet went through, and all it did was it pushed it out of the way by 0.05 seconds. So you still got the fix. It was just a tiny, tiny, tiny bit delayed. And then back down there, we're already getting back into the cycle as normal. So no collisions, minor delay, but everything gets there no matter what. Doesn't get much cooler than that.